out of all technological achievements of our civilization, leaving our planet to explore space is easily one of the greatest, if not the greatest. The ultimate dream of exploring beyond this final frontier didn't start to take hold until the 20th century, and it was science fiction writers that were the first to plant the seeds of this extraordinary idea. In 1865, Jules Verne published his novel From Earth to the Moon. In the story, the main characters wish to construct a giant cannon to launch themselves into space and to land on the moon. In H.G. Wells' novel The War of the Worlds from 1897, the inhabitants of Mars come to invade Earth, and they have traveled to our planet by similar means, using a space gun of sorts to launch their cylinder-shaped spacecraft. These books inspired the people whose work would be vital for the coming space age. However, the earliest scientific explanation for the potential of rockets for space exploration was made a few years earlier by Scottish astronomer and mathematician William Leach in his essay A Journey Through Space from 1861. Rockets had existed for a long time by that point. The origins of rocket technology can be traced back all the way to 10th century China, where gunpowder was invented, the earliest known chemical explosive. The first rockets were powered with gunpowder and were used as fireworks, but also in this machine or these rocket tubes to launch a volley of arrows at enemies, as early as the 13th century in China. This technology spread across Asia and Europe in the next century. Imagine being a soldier on a battlefield back then, and everybody's using swords or spears or bow and arrow, and then all of a sudden you see this guy with this tube coming along, and there's a loud bang, and you and your buddies are pierced with many arrows. It would have seemed like magic or devilry. Also, you'd be dead. To be a bit more positive, seeing fireworks for the first time must have been pretty amazing. And a bit scary, but probably mostly amazing. In the late 1700s, iron-cased rockets were invented in southern India, and these were later modified and used by the British. Rockets were used in many battles and wars in the 1800s, but it wouldn't be until the 1900s that the possibility to use rockets for space travel would become a popular idea, fueled by science fiction stories. Russian scientist Konstantin Tsiolkovsky was the first to theorize many aspects of space travel and rocket propulsion to escape Earth's gravity. That last one is pretty important because using giant cannons or guns powered by gunpowder or dynamite, like in the science fiction stories, are not exactly practical for spaceflight. Instead of one big burst of energy, you need a consistent and reliable amount of thrust to be able to escape Earth's gravity. Tsiolkovsky was an exceptionally productive scientist. He wrote over 400 scientific papers, 90 of which on rocket and space travel. He made designs for rockets with steering thrusters, multi-stage boosters, space stations, airlocks for leaving a spaceship into the vacuum of space, and closed-cycle biological systems to provide food and oxygen for space colonies. He was the first person known to conceive the idea of a space elevator, inspired by the construction of the Eiffel Tower in 1895. In 1903, he calculated the power and speed needed for a craft to reach escape velocity, and the speed it would need to remain in Earth's orbit, and that this could be achieved with a multi-stage rocket fueled with liquid oxygen and hydrogen. His design for a spacecraft would become the basis for modern spaceship design, with a hull divided into three sections. The pilot and co-pilot are in the first section, and the second and third sections hold the fuel. Tsiolkovsky's work was not well known outside of the Soviet Union, but Soviet scientists and engineers were greatly inspired by him, and he was the father of the Soviet space program, and incredible achievements such as the first artificial satellites, and the first man and woman in space. Tsiolkovsky never built a single rocket. He didn't expect any of his theories could ever be used in real life. Fortunately, he was very wrong. Equally as important for the coming age of space exploration was American engineer and physicist Robert H. Goddard. He too was inspired by science fiction stories. While Tsiolkovsky's work was entirely theoretical, Goddard was the first to test these ideas, and he had a few innovations of his own. He created and built the world's first liquid-fuel rocket, which greatly reduced the weight of the rocket and so made it much more effective. He successfully launched it on March 16, 1926. This first flight, and the very first step towards spaceflight, lasted for about 2.5 seconds, rose to 12.5 meters and landed in a nearby cabbage field. That doesn't seem very spectacular, but it effectively proved liquid fuel rockets worked. Today, the launch site is a National Historic Landmark in Auburn in Massachusetts in the United States. Goddard's other great innovation was attaching a so-called de Laval nozzle to the combustion chamber. These nozzles turn the hot gas from the combustion chamber into a cooler jet of gas going faster than the speed of sound because of the pinch in the middle. This doubles the amount of thrust, and so the engine efficiency goes from about 2% to 64%. This was a huge improvement, and it would be vital to not only achieve escape velocity, but to eventually also carry stuff and people into space with bigger rockets. Goddard and his team launched 34 rockets between 1926 and 1941, achieving altitudes as high as 2.6 kilometers and speeds as fast as 885 kilometers per hour. He has been called the man who ushered in the space age, but not during his life. Research into rockets for spaceflight was not considered very valuable around the time Goddard published his paper, A Method of Reaching Extreme Altitudes, in 1919. There was little support from the public and other scientists and engineers in the US. The United States government wasn't very interested in rocket technology in the 1920s, despite the fact that European theorists and engineers were experimenting with their own rockets, for a good part inspired by Goddard's work. Goddard remarked that he would not be surprised if research would become something in the nature of a race. Visionary indeed. The Great Depression of the 1930s resulted in Goddard's one source of funding to be cut for a few years. Only after the Second World War would his work be taken a bit more seriously, but he had always been an introvert and had always been rather secretive with his work, although he did share it with scientists and engineers if they asked him for it. It wouldn't be until years after his death in 1945 that Goddard would be recognized as one of the founding fathers of modern rocket technology. In his time, he was one of the few to realize the potential of rockets for space exploration. He was also the first to scientifically study, design, construct, and fly the type of rockets needed for his dreams and ideas to become reality in a future he never lived to see. While the US failed to see the importance of Goddard's work, it was hugely influential in Europe. One of the European pioneers of rocket engineering was Romanian-born physicist Herman Obert. He had read Goddard's paper on rockets, and his own earliest works on using rockets to explore beyond our planet were considered too utopian by some. Still, he continued to research and publish papers, and there was an interest in spaceflight research slowly growing among his peers. Later, he became a member of the German Spaceflight Society, a group of scientists who would go on to play a major role in making spaceflight a reality. He would be scientific advisor to film director Fritz Lang for his movie The Woman in the Moon, based on a novel written by Lang's wife Thea von Harbo. The movie was released in 1929 and is generally considered one of the first serious science fiction movies. And while it wasn't the first film about flying to the moon, it was the first to realistically show the basics of rocket travel and the use of a multi-stage rocket to a larger audience, thanks to Obert's advice. The film was also the first to introduce the idea of a launch pad and a countdown. Obert even wanted to build a real rocket for the movie, but this was not possible because of budget and time constraints. Europe was also the birthplace of the world's first rocket program in 1927. It was an idea that came from Max Valier, a student of Herman Obert, and he suggested it to Fritz von Opel, a grandson of Adam Opel, the founder of the Opel Automobile Company. Fritz von Opel was fascinated with all kinds of motorsports and won several races with cars and motorbikes. His passion would be instrumental in the popularization of rocket-powered vehicles, and he was co-founder and head of Opel RAK, the very first large-scale experimental rocket program. The program did not so much concentrate on spaceflight, but it resulted in a series of rocket-powered vehicles like cars and airplanes that set speed records on land and in the sky, and drew huge crowds of spectators. It would earn von Opel the nickname Rocket Fritz, and he piloted a number of these vehicles himself, including the world's first public rocket-powered flight, which reached a top speed of 150 km per hour. Another record was set by von Opel using a rocket-powered car, again piloted by the man himself, reaching a top speed of 238 km per hour on the Berlin Speedway, witnessed by a crowd of 3,000 people and the world's media. Opel RAK was immensely popular, but unfortunately the Great Depression of the 1930s forced the Opel company to shut the program down. Just when the engineers were realizing that the solid fuel they were using had its shortcomings and they were busy testing liquid fuel rockets. Max Valier was unfortunately killed in one of these experiments, and so he became the first victim of the dawning space age. We can imagine how different history could have been if Opel RAK had been allowed to continue, and what more it could have meant for rocket technology, but we will never know. It did help pave the way for legendary programs such as Apollo, which put people on the moon, and the Salyut program, which launched the first space station into low Earth orbit. In the 1930s, several rocket programs popped up in Europe, the USA, and the Soviet Union, but they considered weapons development rather than spaceflight. Many rocket engineers working on long-distance weapons for warfare would make a name for themselves in the Second World War. One of the most famous was German engineer and spaceflight pioneer Fernand von Braun. Von Braun had been fascinated by the idea of space travel since childhood, after reading By Rocket to Planetary Space by Herman Obert. He was 16 when he first heard of the feats of the Opel RAK program, and he was so enthusiastic that he decided to build his own rocket car. It was not a success, and the only thing he managed to achieve was to explode the toy car he had attached fireworks to and cause a major uproar in the busy street where he had detonated the toy. And he also got arrested. Even the man that would end up designing the rockets that would take people to the moon had to start somewhere. And he sure seemed to believe he could travel to the moon, even at a young age. In 1930, he attended a lecture by Auguste Piccard, a famous high-altitude balloon flight pioneer, and von Braun told him that he planned to fly to the moon one day. It's said that Piccard responded with encouraging words. Von Braun got a degree in mechanical engineering in 1932 and a doctorate in physics in 1934. And in the meantime, he joined the German Space Flight Society, where he helped to build and test liquid fuel rockets. He would read Goddard's paper and eventually get his hands on a German translation of one of Tchaikovsky's books. In 1933, a certain infamous dictator came into power in Germany, and rocket engineering was immediately moved onto the national agenda. An incredible amount of funding and resources was poured into this rocket and weapons program, and this put Germany way ahead of other nations in that regard. They were deeply interested in Goddard's work, and up until 1939, German scientists regularly contacted the rocket pioneer with technical questions. Von Braun was quickly recruited into this program, and him and his team used Goddard's plans and Tchaikovsky's ideas in the building of a series of ballistic missiles called the Aggregat series, of which the A-4 became the best known. It was commonly called the V-2 rocket, and it was the world's first long-range guided ballistic missile. Technology that can be both beneficial and destructive often finds its way into wars and on battlefields, and it's no different for rockets, which have been used for warfare for almost as long as they have existed. Centuries of death and destruction culminated in the V-2 rocket in 1944. Beginning September of that year, over 3,000 of them were launched against Allied targets, including London and Antwerp. The V stands for the Vergeltungswaffe, German for retaliation or vengeance weapon. While the Allied armies had their own rocket technology and used it in the war, it was all left in the dust by the V-2. Just a couple of months before, in June of 1944, during a test flight, a V-2 rocket reached an altitude of 189 kilometers, well above the line of 100 kilometers, which is the generally agreed upon edge of space. This was actually not considered significant at the time. The beginning of space had just never been defined before, and being in the middle of one of the biggest conflicts the world had ever seen, nobody was really thinking about going to space. Still, it was von Braun and his team's achievement, despite the fact that they were building weapons for war. World War II ended in 1945, and in the aftermath, both the United States and the Soviet Union tried to get their hands on as many German scientists as they could. Von Braun ended up surrendering to the Americans. His expertise made him extremely valuable, and he would go on to play a major part in the upcoming space race of the 1950s and 60s. Naturally, before all of that, he was thoroughly questioned and investigated. And the conclusion was that his involvement with the regime in Germany was purely so he could continue his work, and that he did fear imprisonment or execution. History is often ironic and ambiguous, and the history of rocket science and spaceflight is no exception. Tsiolkovsky didn't believe any of his theories could become reality. Goddard's pioneering work was not taken very seriously in his country, but it ended up being used to build terrifying weapons, designed by the man who would later build rockets to fly people to the moon. And we can wonder how different things could have been if Tsiolkovsky had built rockets, and if Goddard had been celebrated instead of ridiculed. And what if von Braun had been more rebellious and crossed the wrong people? Then maybe his knowledge and skills would have been lost. Either way, the real course of events is fascinating to say the least, and it was no different during the years of the space race, when the USA and the USSR competed for the honor of going down in history as the nation that was the first to land humans on the moon. That's going to be for the next part in this series. Thank you for watching, and I will see you soon.